our eyes upon the cross and run to Him who showed great love and bled for us. Freely You bled for us. Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with Him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Come stand in the light, the glory.
morning, church. Good morning. Isn't it a beautiful Easter Sunday? Amen. Amen. We're so happy you're here. We want you to stand. We're going to worship the Lord in song this morning. And just please sing with us and praise the Lord for what he's done for us today. One. Filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth, be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh, and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Saved me, buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, glorious day.
Day.
want you to sing this one with us.
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river. I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he reigns.
My church.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future and life is worth the living. Just because he lives.
One, two.
I believe in the Son. I believe in the risen. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because he lives. Let my song join the one that never ends.
as he lives. Because he lives.
Amen. Welcome to worship.
Well, good morning. I'd like to welcome you to Wakulla Springs Baptist Church. If you're our guest, know that we're glad that you have joined us this morning on Easter Sunday, where we celebrate the risen Savior Jesus Christ. As we look at the message of Easter, there's one thing that everybody has to form some type of answer. The tomb is empty. You can look at everything else, but the tomb is empty. So for the skeptic, for the one who maybe has a different worldview, for the believer, everybody has to look at the fact that the tomb is empty. So as we celebrate today, we celebrate the risen Savior, Jesus Christ. We celebrate that there's a gospel message that has come to us through the Word of God, through the work of Christ at the cross, and through the risen Savior. This invitation is for those who don't believe to believe, and for those that do believe to keep the faith and to walk it out every day. I want to invite you quickly to look at 1 Peter chapter 1. So you look at the empty tomb, you look at the resurrection of Christ, maybe you've yet to believe, God through His Word invites you to believe. Maybe you are a believer and you're looking for hope and you're looking for something to grab hold of. We remember the promises of God that have been accomplished in Christ and that He will return. And we are to live out in faith until that day. Verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes through the test by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen Him, you love Him. Though you do not now see Him, you believe in Him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Concerning this salvation, the prophets who prophesied about the grace that was to be yours searched and inquired carefully, inquiring what person or time the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating when He predicted the sufferings of Christ and the subsequent glories. It was revealed to them that they were serving not themselves, but you, and the things that you now have been announced to you through those who preach the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. Therefore, preparing your minds for action, and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as He who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, "You shall be holy, for I am holy." And if you call on Him as Father who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for the sake of you, who through Him are believers in God, who raised Him from the dead, and gave Him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. The invitation is there. If you're not a believer, you're invited to believe. The resurrection, the reminder for you to look and to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ for forgiveness of sins and peace with God and everlasting life. If you are a believer, you're called to live it out in faith. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we love you, we praise you, we thank you for today where we celebrate your resurrection. We thank you for the cross, we thank you for the hope that we have in the fulfillment of the promises of God and the promises to come as we look towards your return. We thank you, Lord, for all that you do for us, your many blessings and kindness towards us. Thank you for our church family. We're thankful for all who are here today that you have led them to come hear your word be preached and proclaimed. And as we look to you and to you alone, Lord, we praise your name. We love you and we praise you. Amen.
Amen. If you'll please stand, we're going to sing some more. Praise the Lord. One, two, three. Stars wept, the morning sun was dead, the Savior of the world was falling, his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him.
We sing hallelujah, we
His feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bowed and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed.
Oh Lord, oh Lord, our God.
Lord Jesus Christ, thank you. Thank you so much for your powerful presence. Lord, we just pray that you're among us today. We know you're here, that you are alive, and we know what you've done for us. Lord, we pray that your Spirit just fills this entire church and that people come to know you that don't know you, and those that do know you better. Lord, we just pray that you continue to bless this place. In your name we pray. Amen.
I did a Google search this week for this phrase, when you have no hope. I just typed that in. I wanted to see what would come up, when you have no hope. There were a lot of results that were returned. About four or five down, as you kind of scrolled, four or five, I don't remember which, there was a Reddit post that caught my eye because of the title. And it said this: all hope is lost. What do I do now? And I thought, I wonder what that's about. So I clicked on it. Just like to read you just a little bit of what this person posted. I'm honestly just so sad all the time. Loneliness has consumed my life and my thoughts. I'm at work with a pile of tasks that I have no intention of doing anytime soon. All I can think of is how daunting the rest of my life is right now, because I can see it clearly. Another 30 or 40 years of getting up, going to work, coming home to an empty house, eating dinner, playing video games until arthritis and carpal tunnel catch up to me, then just watching movies, then going to sleep to do it all over again. The weekends just remove work from the equation. That's all my life has been the last 5 to 8 years. That's all it will be until I die. Why do I not only think this, but absolutely know it with every fiber of my being? Quite simply because there's no way anything else is possible. I know myself well enough to know that I will never have the motivation, discipline, or sheer willpower to change anything about my life. The ability to force myself to work out or change careers or make friends was bullied out of me at a very young age. What few friends stuck around are long gone. The only people that remain in my life are biologically programmed to do so. Once they're gone, I will have no one until the day I die. And then it continues. But that gives you a taste of all hope is lost. What do I do now? It was a sad, sad post. The replies maybe were even sadder, because the first few said basically ditto for my life. I feel the same way. I don't have any hope. There's nothing I can do to change anything about this. I'm miserable. I'm sad. They echoed, all hope is lost, what do I do now? The only answer that was given was, hey, you should move to another country. That was it. Like, hey, move to another country. It'll be a new language, new things. Maybe it'll shake you up or something. And the person said, well, I'm a customer service rep in Canada. I can't speak the language of another country. What would I do? And they were like, I'll just move to another country. So I have no hope in my life. I look down the line and I see misery. I'm miserable now. Misery's coming. All hope is lost. What do I do? And the best that anybody could offer was just move to another country and hope that helps. You know, that title, all hope is lost, what do I do now? That's what caught my attention with this post. I believe if we could have just kind of joined the group on the first Easter morning, a group of women that were headed to the graveyard, I think in that kind of dark, kind of light, you know, it's dawning, can't see really well, but if we could have gotten a clear look At their eyes, we would have noticed they were swollen and red from shedding a lot of tears over the past couple of days. And if we could have seen the look on their faces, we would have known these are people that have lost hope. And if somehow they would have had a phone and a Reddit account and could have posted, I think on the way to the tomb of Jesus, they might have posted, "All hope is lost. What do I do now?" In Matthew 28, we are going to walk with them to that tomb. We're going to try to figure out, okay, they go there with no hope, but something changed. So how do you find hope when you have no hope? What is it that changes that dynamic? Well, verse 1 of Matthew 28. And here we see for these ladies, and actually for all the disciples that did not show up at the tomb first thing in the morning, all hope was lost. Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. What's a tomb for? What do you do with a tomb? Yeah, you bury dead people in a tomb, right? Another word would be grave. They're coming to the tomb of Jesus. Why? Because when Jesus died, the Sabbath was approaching, and they started the process of preparing his body for burial, but they couldn't finish it because the Sabbath was coming and they had to stop. And so now they're coming after the Sabbath on that first Easter morning, and they're coming to finish that job. So that's not a fun task, right? That's not something you look forward to. They're coming, and they're filled with sorrow. Their hearts are broken, and they're coming to a tomb. And a tomb speaks of death, right? So we know that Jesus died. On the cross, he died. Now, we know why he died. He died for our sins. The Bible makes that clear. Christ Jesus, he died for our sins according to the scriptures. That's what the Bible says. That's at the heart of the gospel message. He died for our sins. So his death was in our place. It was in your place. It was in my place. It was not for his sins. He had none, but for our sins. But he died and he's dead. And they're coming to his tomb, and they expect to find the body of Jesus in that grave. That was their present reality. Jesus is dead. That's all that consumed their vision. That's all that consumed their thoughts. Jesus is dead. You would agree with me, right, that just on the face of it, death is awful. I mean, it's called our enemy in Scripture, our last great enemy. Death, for us on this side of it, it brings separation from loved ones. It brings grief. It brings a soul anguish that is actually hard to describe. It's hard to explain it. And I know there's a resurrection that's coming. There's a resurrection of the just. There's a resurrection of the unjust. But before that time, between now and that time, I mean, death is just really final, isn't it? Right? I mean, it's just so final. It's horrible. I've done a lot of funeral services throughout the years of being a pastor, and I've never had anybody come back. You understand? Like we bury them, and whether that was done 30 years ago or 3 years ago, it's final, right? Like they're gone. And that brings sorrow. And compound that sorrow for these women coming to the tomb, because not only was Jesus a good friend or someone that they loved, but this is the death of one that they believed was the Messiah, right? This is the one that they had put their hope in. This is the one that they had followed. They had trusted him. They had believed. This is the Messiah. This is the one that God promised to send into the world. This is the one that's going to redeem Israel. That was their hope. In fact, to other disciples in some of the resurrection accounts, talking to Jesus but not knowing it's Jesus, said, they say that. We had hoped that he was the one that would redeem Israel. But obviously, if he's dead, he's not. So they not only were dealing with the death of one that they loved, that's hard enough and horrible enough, but their faith, their hope, their trust, everything had been devastated. And they're going to a graveyard to finish the burial process for Jesus. You could understand why they might post to a Reddit account if they had the availability. All hope is lost. What do I do now? What are we going to do? Where do we turn now? We believed he had the words of eternal life. We believed he was the Messiah. What are we going to do now? There's a hopelessness as they head to that tomb. But in that graveyard, they came face to face with a new reality that changed everything. So today's not a story of no hope. But out of hopelessness, hope arises. Out of despair, victory steps forth in the midst of a graveyard. And so they came face to face with that new truth, that new reality about Jesus Christ. And I'd like to bring you face to face with that same truth this morning, if you would allow me to do so. Verse 2. Behold, there was a great earthquake. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door. So when we think grave, you're burying someone in the ground, right? There was a tomb that literally would have been carved out like a cave. And then there would have been a big stone rolled in front of it to seal it. And so this angel comes down and rolls that stone back from the door, sits on top of the stone. His countenance was like lightning. His clothing was white as snow. The guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. The guards that had been placed there to guard the tomb of Jesus, well, they pass out. They faint. They're terrified. I mean, you would be too, right? If you're in a graveyard and suddenly this being comes down, there's an earthquake and this being comes down in bright shining garments and shining brightly, rolls his stone out of a way and sits on top of it, you think you would just say, "What's up?" I don't think so. You'd be terrified out of your mind too. They faint. These Roman soldiers or these guards, they faint away. Well, the women show up. They actually had a question, not recorded in Matthew, but recorded in one of the other gospel accounts. How are we going to roll that stone out of the way? And they get there, and it's done. And the angel speaks to them, and their sad reality was invaded by the hope of Easter and the truth of Easter. Hopelessness gives way to worship and purpose. What changed for them? Well, look at verse 5. The angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified." The angel acknowledges, "I understand that Jesus was dead." Right? No denial of that. No, like, hey, he just passed out on the cross, or actually that was not Jesus on the cross. None of that nonsense. I know what you're looking for. You're here looking for the body of Jesus who was crucified, and he was. He was crucified on that cross for our sins, and the angel acknowledges his death, right? But wait a minute. There's no period, like that's the end of the story type stuff. No. Keep reading. "I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay." That's awesome. I'm telling you, that's awesome. That is what today is all about. It's not about anything else but that. He is not here. He is no longer in that tomb, the angel said. He is risen. That's the truth of Easter. Jesus was crucified, dead, but now he's not in the grave. He's risen as he said. He rose from the dead. He was dead. Yes, he was dead. No trick, no gimmick. He was dead, but now he's alive. They're expecting to find his dead body, but his dead body's not there because his dead body is alive now. Jesus is alive. And the angel told them that, and it literally changed everything. Jesus is risen. Christ is risen. That changes everything. It just does. Now, please understand, this is literal. This is bodily. Like, his body came out of the grave, right? It's not a metaphor. It's not a symbol. It's not an allegory. He literally was dead. If that's the tomb behind those doors, he's in there. He's stretched out. He's wrapped in burial garments. But then he arose. His body came out of the tomb. He's alive, and he lives forevermore. That's the truth of what we're celebrating today. Don't miss it, okay? Sometimes we overlook the obvious. Jesus arose from the dead. That's what we're proclaiming today. That's what this is all about. Now, have you ever played horse? Have you ever added call your shot? Like, okay, it might be as simple as this is going to be nothing but net. You call your shot. Or this is going to be a bank shot. Or if you're really good, I'm going to bounce this off the ground. It's going to go up, hit the backboard, bounce in, and you call your shot, right? Well, the resurrection of Jesus Christ was the greatest call-your-shot moment of all time. Because Jesus told his followers, they didn't understand, their eyes were kind of blinded to it, but he told his followers, I'm going to die, I'm going to be crucified, and on the third day, I'm going to rise again. That's calling your shot, right? And that's better than nothing but net. Now, anybody can say that, right? Any of you, I could say that. Any of us could say that. I'm going to die, and the third day I'm going to rise from the grave. Any of us could say that, but only Jesus could do that. He called a shot. And what does that do? That gives confirmation to us that he is who he claimed to be. He is who he said he was. If you can say, I'm going to die, and then you die, and then you said before, I'm going to rise from the dead 3 days later, and you do, hey, we'll believe what you said, right? Because you're demonstrating, I'm not merely a human here. Jesus said, I'm the Son of God. I'm the Messiah. And he proved it. He was demonstrated, proven to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection of the dead, the first chapter of Romans says. So this is the call your shot moment. This is awesome. Jesus demonstrated that he was exactly who he claimed to be. Yesterday we had our Easter egg hunt, and I announced at the beginning of it, I said, hey, parents, be aware there's candy in all of these eggs, right? If you were here, you remember that. Well, I was given like a heads up, especially for small children, like, hey, make sure you understand there's candy in there. They might start putting it in their mouth, and maybe you don't want them to, but just be aware. So at the end of it, this girl comes up to me. She doesn't look happy. And she said, this was rigged. This was all rigged. And I said, what do you mean, it's rigged? She said, there was no candy in those eggs I found. I said, there was no candy in those eggs. She said, it was rigged. It was all rigged. I mean, she was very agitated about it. It's all rigged. And I said, well, maybe it fell out of your eggs, or maybe, I don't know, somehow maybe we hid some eggs that didn't have candy in it. They were supposed to all have eggs in it. I thought they were supposed to have eggs in them, but or candy in the eggs. But she just kept looking at me under her breath, muttering, this was rigged. This was all rigged. And she finally turned and walked away. What if Easter is rigged? What if it's like a hoax or a scam? Like, it's not real. It didn't really happen. That's all rigged, Bible stuff. It's not. It didn't happen. What would be the implications of that? Well, keep your finger here, and we're coming right back to it in just a moment. But in 1 Corinthians, Paul addressed that. He said, if Jesus is not risen, then actually we really do have no hope. And all that we've believed and all that we've trusted has turned out to be worse than useless. In verse 12 of 1 Corinthians 15. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there's no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. Yes, we are found false witnesses of God because we testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not raise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. Paul said, look, if Jesus is not raised from the dead, then your faith is worthless. It's empty. It's useless. In fact, he says, you're still in your sins. Oh, you've said, oh, I've trusted Jesus and he's forgiven me of my sins. And Paul's saying, no, that's not real if Christ is not raised from the dead. In fact, the loved ones that you knew that trusted Christ that have died, Paul said, well, they've just perished. We know the wonderful truth that God so loved the world that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. But if you've believed in something that's not real, that's not true, then it doesn't do you any good either now nor beyond the grave. So if the resurrection is not true, if Easter is rigged, then all that we believe is useless. It's of no value. So this is pretty important, right? This is a pretty big deal. So the angel, back in Matthew 28, invited them. He announced that Christ is risen. But he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. He wanted them to see it for themselves. Because here's the bottom line. The resurrection is real. It's not a fable. It's not a hoax. It's not rigged. It's real whether I believe it or whether I don't believe it. It's a historical reality. Now, my believing it brings change into my life. It brings hope into my life. My not believing it leaves me in hopelessness, but it doesn't change the fact, right? Let me demonstrate that, or try to demonstrate that. Somebody move my Easter egg. What are you doing? I had my Easter egg over there, and it was not there. It was gone, but for a different reason. It was rigged. So, what do you think about the law of gravity? You believe it? Well, let's see. What happens if I drop this egg? Well, it falls, right? And it'll keep falling, and it'll keep falling. Why? It'll go down, down, down as far as it can go. Why? Well, gravity. I'm not going to explain gravity to you, all right? I'm not sure I can. But I know that things fall down, right? Not up. They don't float in the air. There's a pull. There's a gravitational pull that's related to the earth, and it affects all of us all the time, right? All the time. You don't get away from it. You can't get away from it. I'm not saying you can't go up in a rocket, but you're not going to stay up there. You're going to end up coming back down. Gravity is real. But what if somebody in the crowd said, I don't believe in gravity. Isaac Newton came up with that nonsense, sitting under that apple tree, hit him on the head, gave him a concussion, and he came up with gravity, right? And you say, I don't believe it. Well, how will that affect if I drop this egg? It won't affect it at all, will it? If I say, I do not believe in gravity, well, it didn't change anything about gravity, did it? Now, it might change things about my life. I might do things if I didn't believe in gravity that I wouldn't do if I did believe in gravity. I might end up harming myself or harming someone else because I don't accept the fact. But it doesn't change the fact. And that's my point. Listen, we're called upon to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, his death for our sins, his glorious resurrection from the grave. But if you don't believe it, it doesn't change anything about the fact. Nothing, not one single thing. It does change your relationship to the fact. It does position you either in a place of hope or hopelessness, of purpose or no purpose. But your lack of faith, if you don't believe, I'm so glad that you're here today. There's no manipulation here, no tricks here, not rigged, no gimmicks. I do encourage you to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're glad that you come. Hope that you're investigating and exploring if you don't believe. But if you don't believe, it doesn't change anything about the reality. Gravity's gravity. Christ arose from the dead. And you need to believe it for yourself. That's why the angel said, come and see. You come and see the place where the Lord lay. You must be convinced for yourself. Your grandmother's faith is not sufficient. Your father's faith is not sufficient. I don't mean what they believed. I mean the fact that they believed will not cause you to be credited with their belief. You have to believe. You have to be convinced, right? This is a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, the change is so dramatic. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You will be saved, but you have to confess. You have to believe. You have to be personally convinced for yourself. Do you believe? Do you believe what it says there? That actually Christ rose from the dead? That he was not there, he was risen. And those women did go in and see the place where the Lord had been laying. Do you believe that? And what does it mean to believe? Have you trusted him? Have you received him? Not just believed that historically it happened, but you have turned to him from your sins, believing in the glorious resurrected Christ. All hope is lost. What do I do now? Well, that changed. It changed dramatically on that first Easter morning. These women now, they have hope again. Now their lives have been changed. Now they know for sure that the one that they had hoped was actually the Messiah. And now they have a purpose. I want to show you two things. If we change that phrase, all hope is lost, what do I do now? When you believe in the resurrected Jesus Christ, hope is found in Christ, but you still need to ask, what do I do now? Jesus is risen. What do I do now? I believe that. What do I do now? I've personally received him. What do I do now? Look at verse 7. The angel said to these women, first come and see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he's risen from the dead. And indeed, he's going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I've told you. So they went out from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them. So this is not an angel anymore. Jesus shows up in the path saying, rejoice. So they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. And we're going to cycle back to that go tell his disciples. Here's one of the first changes that it makes in your life when you believe. It says they worshiped him. So they're coming to that tomb with no hope. And now when they see Christ and they hear the resurrection story and they see that empty tomb and they believe, they place themselves at the feet of Jesus Christ and they worship him. The first outworking of believing on Jesus is now I worship him. You know what the word worship means? At the heart of it, like the root of that word, it means to bow. Now, there's a lot more surrounding that, but at the very heart of that word, it means to bow. It means, I don't have good knees, but it means I'm acknowledging who he is. I'm acknowledging his worth, his holiness, and I'm placing myself at his feet. I am acknowledging his lordship, who he is. It's not just about singing a song, right? Right? Y'all aren't committing to much today. Come on, wake up. It's a little warm in here, but it's not that warm. It's acknowledging who Christ is. He is my Lord and my God. You remember the story of Thomas? He's the one disciple that when Jesus showed up that first night to appear to all the disciples and Thomas was out. He missed church that night, right? I don't know what he's doing, but he was out. Well, the other guys are saying, hey, man, we saw Jesus. He's alive. And you know what Thomas said? I won't believe it. I will, unless I put my finger in that nail print hole and stick my hand in his side, I will not believe it. He was a skeptic, right? He's tagged doubting Thomas, but actually, he more appropriate, he was unbelieving Thomas. He didn't seem to have much doubt, did he? He's like, I'm not believing that. I was born at night, but it wasn't last night. I'm not falling for this, guys. You guys have all gone crazy. He's dead. I don't believe that. A week later, Jesus shows up in that same room, and Thomas happened to be there that night, right? And he addresses Thomas specifically. And he invites Thomas to come look at these wounds. Come examine it for yourself. And he said, reach your finger here. Look at my hands. Reach your hand here. Put it in my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believing. He calls on unbelieving Thomas, stop being an unbeliever. But believe. I'm alive. I'm right here in front of you. Believe. Thomas answered and said to him, you see it? Well, you're not looking at it, but here it is. My Lord and my God. My Lord and my God. You see that response? When the women worshiped him, that's what they're saying. They're placing themselves at the feet of Jesus. They're acknowledging who he is, and they worship him. And here Thomas is saying, Lord, I don't have any more questions. You are my Lord and my God. That submission, that surrender, that's believing. And Jesus affirmed that. He said to him, Thomas, because you've seen me, you've believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. And that's us. We've not seen Jesus with our physical eye, but yet we believe the testimony of God's word, the testimony of the witnesses, and the work of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. And Jesus said, Thomas, you've seen and believed, and that's good, but a special blessing to those who've not seen, yet they've believed. But notice, he worshiped. He said, my Lord and my God. Now see, let's understand. That's what we're being called to. If we believe that Jesus rose from the dead, then he's Lord and we're not. And that's where you find hope, right? Hey, run your own life. You'll make a mess of it. You'll make a mess of it. You'll drive yourself and steer yourself right into hopelessness. Just do your own thing. Say, well, God, I know you said that, but I'm not going to do that. Well, that's someone who doesn't believe. But place yourself at the feet of the resurrected Christ, my Lord and my God, and I worship him. I'm surrendered to him. I'm submitted to him. That's the first thing everyone who believes ought to do. You are my Lord. You are my God. I yield myself to you. But there's a second thing. All hope is lost. What do I do now? Well, that gives way to hope is found in Jesus. What do I do now? I worship him. I submit to him. I surrender him. I acknowledge him. And I live life with a purpose. Jesus told them, verse 10, Jesus said to them, he echoed what the angel had said. Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee, and there they will see me. Ladies, you came here with one purpose, and that was to anoint my body to finish the burial process, but you can forget that. Appreciate it, but I don't need that. But I do have a purpose for your life. You go and tell. You now have seen me. You now know that I've been raised from the dead. Hey, spread the news. Go tell Peter. Go tell James. Go tell John. Go tell my followers. Go let them know this good news, because this is not a secret, right? This is not something that, don't tell anybody. Let's keep this to ourselves. No. This is a message that went to the disciples, because the disciples didn't believe in the resurrection of Christ at the beginning. But then they were convinced, and then they went and told the world. And that gospel message actually worked its way from them all the way down around to right here. We have a purpose if we believe. And that purpose is higher than what I do for a living. It's higher than how many points are on the buck that you bag this past season, or how big the fish is that you caught. There's a higher purpose than that. It's a higher purpose than whether your team wins or loses, thankfully, right? Because a lot of times they lose when you thought they were going to win. If you believe in Jesus Christ, that he died for our sins, he was buried, and that he arose from the dead, which is the heart of the gospel message, you're going to want other people to know about that. You're going to want other people to be informed about that, because the hopelessness that once characterized your life, you want them to now know the hope that you have through Jesus Christ. And you want them to know the reality that he's alive. The death and resurrection of Jesus, it changes your life, but only if you believe it. Come and see, they were invited. Come and see the place, and then go and tell. Go and tell. Let his followers know. That was the first. But beyond that, send the word, send the news. Christ is raised. He is risen indeed. And it changes your life. Not believing facts about Jesus. You have to do that in order to believe on Jesus and to receive him. This brings about a dramatic change in a person's life from hopelessness to hope. I don't mean there's no struggle anymore. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying, when you know Jesus, there's a resurrected Lord who is always with you, who gives you the power and the strength to live life for his glory and for his honor. I want to show you a testimony. In the testimony, they don't specifically mention Easter, but these testimonies were given on Easter Sunday. Two people that knew about Jesus but didn't know Jesus. But then they came to know Jesus, and you listen to the change that he made in their lives. Let's play the video.
Growing up, I knew a lot about Jesus. I was very proud of that.
I always knew about Jesus growing up. I prayed before bed, and I would have conversations with him, but I really was always in a place where, you know, God had to do things my way. My prayers were very one-sided.
I was a pastor. One night, it just really became clear to me that I needed to make a choice. Something needed to.
can only be found in Jesus. We try to stuff things into our lives to fill that void that only Jesus can fill. And he can fill that void because he is the one who died for our sins. He was buried, and he arose again the third day. And when you believe that, it changes everything about your life. Do you believe? Have you received him? Is he your Lord and your God? That's who he is. Have you acknowledged that in your life? Let's stand together. I don't know what brought you here today. Glad that you are here. But it's Jesus who gives us victory. It's Jesus who enables us to overcome the hopelessness and despair of this world. Do you believe? Do you believe that he is risen, that he came out of that grave? If so, acknowledge him, my Lord and my God. You are Lord, you are Savior, you are God. It'll change your life forever. This is not about getting religious. This is about being saved and forgiven. It's about Jesus, the one who died and is raised, that we celebrate today. Have you received him? If you have, worship, purpose, tell people. If not, come to Jesus. He gives us the victory. Father, speak to us. Lord, help us to believe. If there's anyone here who's not believed, I pray they would turn to Christ in repentance and faith and believe on him and be saved. And Lord, for those who have, thank you for the hope. Help us to walk in it, to live in light of the fact that he is Lord and God, to worship him, to tell others. In the name of Christ, I pray. Amen.
We're so happy that you've come join worship the Lord today with us. We want to send you out with the good news of Christ, victory in Jesus. So please sing this song loud for all to hear so that we can send it out into the world.
Bought me with his redeemed.
to be dismissed with prayer, but before we go, I just want to read you something. I bought this book for my grandson. He's 4 now. I bought it. Actually, we were reading to him before he was born. 4 months old, excuse me. I heard a groan from that section. 4 months old, not 4. Boy, how time flies. So we bought it before he was born, and we would read to him from this over, like, video phone call. So while he was here a couple of weeks ago, I read him this story 3 times. It's from A Child's Garden of Bible Stories. What's today all about? Very early on the 3rd day, God sent an angel to roll the stone from the door of the tomb. The earth shook and the soldiers were afraid. They fell to the ground as if they were dead. 3 women came to visit Jesus' tomb. They saw the stone had been rolled away. They looked in the tomb, but it was empty. What had happened? Jesus was not there. 2 angels in gleaming garments appeared to the women. The angel said, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? Jesus is not here. He's risen, just like he said he would." The women ran back to Jerusalem and told the disciples what they had seen. Peter and John hurried to the tomb to see for themselves. The grave was empty. Mary came back to the tomb and felt sad. Mary heard someone close by. She thought it was the man in charge of the garden. "Sir, if you've taken away Jesus, please tell me where you put him." The man said, "Mary." Then Mary knew that it was Jesus. She turned and said, "Master." Jesus said, "Go and tell my disciples that I'm alive again and that I will soon go to my Father in heaven." Mary was happy. She ran to the disciples and told them that Jesus was alive and that he had spoken to her. If you've believed that, you need to tell somebody. Go and tell that he's alive. It makes all the difference in people's lives. Travis, you pray for us, please, and we'll be dismissed.